you. Hi, my name is Ramya, and okay, this crowd is much bigger than I thought it would be. So, I'm not a developer, and I'm not a techie in any sense of the word. In fact, I call myself a techno-Greek, just technology is Greek to me. But I've been a digital native for about 20 years now. Yeah, I'm actually really old. And I've been a WordPress user for about 7 years, and I run a few blogs. I run about 10 blogs at one point of time. I run two actively now, and so WordPress has been a very active part of that journey. And so what I do has evolved along with WordPress. I've seen WordPress itself shape and shift over the past 7 years, and it's given me a new identity because of the new features and all the new things that have been made possible. So that's as much WordPress plugging as I'm going to do, and I'm not going to really talk about WordPress after this. So I was promised that they would be terrorizing if I didn't mention the word WordPress in enough number of times. So since that's not going to happen, and I don't have a... Okay. So I'm going to have to keep jumping behind the podium to change the... Wait, I'm good if you don't mind. Can somebody just come up here and... okay, thanks. I'll just tell you. Okay, before you switch. So, what did... I'm sure all of you have read the agenda and you're here at 11 in the morning for a good reason. Do you have any idea what this talk could be about? Anybody? Any thoughts? This is a randomly thought. I'll get up in the morning and come. Hoga kuch? So, I'm not really going to give you anything of value. I'm not going to teach you anything that you didn't know. So, caveat. I'm telling you all this beforehand, okay? So, don't blame me. You can blame Alex and tell him really because he promised to terrorize me. So, my talk is called An Analog in a Digital World, which is a little bit of a trick you'll find. I'm not going to talk about anything electronic. So this is not analog and digital in that sense. What I'm going to do is flesh out the world that I've seen evolving in the past 20 years and the different things that are happening and the roles that I think we are playing. So I think of Digitalia as a parallel universe. It's like a new planet. Well, maybe not that new, but it's still new compared to planet Earth. So, let's look at what's been happening on planet Australia. Okay, so in the beginning there were the explorers. This is what happens in any new land or any new planet, right? So there were all these brave people who went out and said, where we are sucks. We need to try and find something different, something new. So these guys are the explorers. Are these terms familiar? Are there a lot of techies or internet geeks? If not, I'll throw in a few references. The US Department of Defense commissioned a whole lot of money trying to understand how communication could be done in a better way than telegram and telegraph and so on and so forth. ARPANET was one of the early predecessors of everything that we use today. ARPANET was a predecessor of the World Wide Web. At some point of time, National Science Foundation got involved and they funded the Computer Science Network. So I won't get into the history of how this happened, but these guys were pretty much the ones right at the start, starting at believe in the 1960s, saying that let's go and explore what can be done through wires and through other forms of communication. It started off as a need for better communication, faster, quicker, safer, more accessible. This is a cartoon that appeared in 1926 in a German magazine by a guy called Karl Arnold, and he labeled it wireless telephony. 1926, okay, so the telephones at that time used to look like this. You can see those big things with a, you know, you hold it up and there is a receiver here. I don't know, are most of you too young to remember landline phones?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. So this is what a telephone used to look like. It used to be really big, and this guy in 1926 said, someday maybe there will be people walking around without the need for a wire, but that's as far as he could imagine. So he still showed, well, old people in old looking fashions carrying old fashioned phones with a huge receiver connected with a wire to their pockets. But the concept of wireless telephony was thought up at that time. Now another thinker. So this is Arthur C. Clarke, one of the greats of science fiction. So he said fiction is more than non-fiction in some ways. And a lot of the ideas that he opposed in his books and his stories are reality today. But they were all seen as this crazy stuff that's completely impossible, it's all fantasy, back when he was writing. And in 1959, he came out with a book. Okay, why didn't I take it? So that's as much of a techno geek as I am. The first time I'm working on this. So he wrote a book called Profiles in the Future, in which he's actually predicted that at some point of time there would be small handheld devices that people could carry around and communicate with each other. He even predicted geotagging. This was in the 1950s, okay? So I'm including these guys because I think all of them were explorers. While the first guys, the US Department of Defense, all those guys who created ARPANET and the internet as we know it today, those guys were technological explorers. These guys were thought explorers. They were thinking about things, they were imagining things, and until you imagine something, how can you even think about how to make it possible, right? So thank you to all these guys, I think, for making the internet possible. And the internet being the foundation of digital as we know it. Now, once a new land has been discovered, what next? There are all these guys who come in and start building stuff. So these things are reasonably familiar. Bell Labs, anyway, the first telephone, then the first mobile phones. AT&T came out with the first mobile service provider. America Online. Has anyone here actually ever used America Online? Awesome. Okay, great. So I've never used America Online, but you know, it's one of those things that I believe children will study about in history textbooks someday. So again, I'd say roughly 90s or even before that, I think, is where these guys started building stuff that, on this open space that the earlier guys had discovered. Does anybody remember this? Anyone? Okay, how many Apple fanboys or fangirls here? Okay. So I'm not an Apple person myself. I use an Apple computer. I'm not a huge fan of Apple. But for this one thing, I'll say hats off to them. America Online was originally an Apple product, and then they sold it over. And at some point of time, they discovered that there would be a need for digital communities. So they came up with this. This is eWorld. And eWorld existed in the 90s, the mid-90s, 94 to 96. I've actually had the privilege of using eWorld. So you signed in onto the internet. You remember when you dialed in and there'd be the sound of two computers talking? And this is the screen. If you were an eWorld user, this is the screen it would open to. And it was a really, so this is not a very good picture. It was a very nice, almost 3D looking picture. You could click on whichever service that you needed to go to. And the whole thing is so nicely designed from a user interface point of view. So there's email over there which will take you to your mailbox. There's community center, which was the chat rooms of those days, 94, okay, note. And then marketplace, which was e-commerce. Newsstands was what we'd understand as a news feed today. So this was happening in the 90s, and yeah, Apple made that possible. I believe eWorld is still in existence, but it's not open to regular janta regularly. But I think these guys were also doing some fabulous stuff back then. So, you know, the space was starting to take shape. There were actual constructions happening. If you can think of virtual estate as a thing, these are the people who are shaping what was to come. Now, what happens once there are buildings? Nobody knows. We all live in buildings, right? We are in a building right now. So there are people who come in and start doing stuff to buildings. There's graffiti and there's all kinds of other things. There's carpenters and shoemakers and whatnot. I like to think these guys are the artisans. So they're all doing cool things. They're not actually building stuff. They're making these little things which make life just a little more interesting and entertaining on Digitalia. There's a whole bunch of other examples. So, but I'm sure you get the point. There's Farmville, there's gaming, there's communication systems, there's a whole, that beast called social media. But what happens with all this? These guys are all trying to pull in people. The architects just said, okay, fine, we build something, now people will come. The artisans said, okay, here, we're doing our cool stuff. And then the rest of us, the regular janta, started flooding it. So that's when it became this crazy, all kinds of structures and stuff and things happening, which is where we started needing people and entities and order in the chaos to drive people everywhere. So the city planners. So do we know what a city planner does? A city planner's job is to ensure that life is being lived a lot more comfortably and efficiently in urban centers, cities and towns. So where roads go, how traffic flows, where there should be a building, where there should be a park instead, where there should be a school. That's pretty much what a city planner does. Maybe we in Mumbai are a little alien to the concept of city planners because, well, we don't have place for city planners here. These guys were the original city planners. These are the early search engines. Then of course, this came up and kind of absorbed everything else, swallowed everything. Now, I think AltaVista still exists and it kind of collates. So I can see a few techie people nodding their heads. So thank you for the validation. I looked up all this yesterday online. I think this one also falls under city planning. Because Google is helping us organize the internet better. And Facebook is helping us organize human interactions and communities. So I like to think of those as tribes better. Okay? Which takes me to, now that we've got people, we've got a place, we've got lives being lived on digitalia, what do you think is the currency? Because people are going to need currency, right? We are all, it's a very human thing. They're going to need to transact with each other. So, thoughts?
Traffic,
okay. Anybody else?
Knowledge,
all right. Content, okay. Content, traffic, knowledge. Advertising, okay.
Reputation,
all right.
Virtual money, like
Bitcoin. Okay, virtual money. I'd say virtual money is more like, virtual money is actually an analog of real money. But it's not the currency, it's like, it's an analog. It'll pass for real money. So this is a metaphor. All of these are metaphors for what's happening between the two worlds, the real world and digitalia. But I think there is a currency of this place itself, not just...
Creativity?
I think all of those things are aspects that come into the world, into the digital space. They transcend the digital and the real world, right? It's a human thing. Ability to comprehend data. Okay, I think that would fall more under the earlier one, which is you comprehend data, then you understand how to analyze it, and then you understand how to organize it in a systematic manner, right? But I'm talking about currency. Currency is basically, we all need different things and we all have different things. So currency came up because we needed a common denominator to, a common measure to be able to barter with each other, right? So what is the currency of digitalia? Now here's a clue. I'm sure a lot of you have seen this cartoon before. Can you read at the back? Is it clear? Or has it gotten all pixelated? Is it clear? No? Okay, so that, this guy is saying you rock and that guy is saying you rule. So what's happening over here? These are two different entities. They're talking, right? They are acknowledging each other, they are saying, okay, what happens when any two people meet? You don't necessarily interact immediately, right? You look at each other, the little, okay, all right.
Communication.
Yeah, and how does communication happen? Let's say I decided to speak in Tamil. So, maybe, I don't know.
Body language.
Right, so we find a common language to speak in. If not the verbal language, we find a common, some other language that we could communicate in. And once we started, what would be the first thing we'd say? Hello, right? And then probably we'd introduce ourselves, and then we'd think, each of us would decide, okay, fine, this person is okay to talk to, maybe let me talk. So what we do is first recognize, then we validate, and then we interact. And isn't this how technology works as well? You plug in one device into another, the first thing it does is the two devices need to recognize each other. Are they both compatible? Are they both speaking the same language? The next level is validation. Is this secure? You'll get a pop-up, right, saying there's a virus on this device and, you know, are you sure you don't want to go ahead with this? Or when you visit a website also, you get kind of stuff like that. And only after that do interactions begin. That's the whole process of it. So I think interactions are the transactions and hence the currency of digitalia. Interactions are transactions of information and power. I think somebody mentioned information. I don't think information itself is the currency. Interaction is the currency in which information is bartered. Information and power. So now that we've got a currency as well, can we safely say we've now moved from being a space into a civilization? We are actually, there's norms and there's etiquette and there are communities clustered around, there are agreed upon modes of behavior. So we've become more than a bunch of living creatures and habits on a space, right? We've become collective in our consciousness and in our intelligence and in how we approach things on digital media.
So this is where I get into the big C's of Digitalia. Content, I think, is the first C. Content is identity. Who you are on the space has everything to do with what kind of content you put out there, whether it's a website or a Facebook page or just a comment somewhere else, right? Before I get to the slide, I'll stop and tell you a little bit about what I do for a living. I am a digital storyteller. I help businesses understand how to use narratives in their work, stories in their work. And I do all of this because I am a self-professed content expert, which happens because of WordPress. Because WordPress has made it possible to be a content specialist and not just a writer. So that's another WordPress plug. I hope somebody's listening. So this is one of the pieces of content. This is something I do fairly often. These are photo stories that I put up. That's me. That's a picture of me. And that's a little poem I wrote. It says, poetry comes rolling out of my pursed lips like smoke curling under the door. Somebody is going to get burned soon. And this is a cartoon. This is a series I run called Andheri Girl. And anybody who's following my content understands a little bit about me because of these pieces that I put up. They know I live in Andheri. They know I look like that. They know I'm very savvy on these two platforms. So my identity is being established because of what I say, how I say, who I say it to, and when I say it, and on what platforms I say. Incidentally, Ideasmith has been my identity for 10 years. It started off as an anonymous blog, and today, a lot of my friends, Ankur, for instance, still introduces me to people as Idea. I think his, a lot of my friends, my phone number is stored on their phones as Ideasmith. So Ideasmith is a stronger part of my identity than my real name. Because the content I put out there has been going out as Ideasmith. And all of these are part of Ideasmith. They draw from my real life, but they're part of this parallel avatar I have called Ideasmith on Digitalia. This is a blog I run, which is pseudo-feminist, tough woman, pseudo-tough woman. So this again tells you something about Ideasmith. I'm not going to say it tells you something about me, it tells you something about Ideasmith, the kind of person I am, the kind of people I interact with, the kind of interactions I'm hoping for. Which leads me into the kind of connections that happen. So once content is put out there, connection is the next validation, right? So you're an identity, you've created this. This is me, this is my home, this is where I exist on Digitalia. What next? Interactions can't happen until validation happens. And connections are all the validation. So who you know, who knows you, who wants to listen to you. Do the terms cloud, peer index, cred, do these things make any sense to people here, or are they a little, I can see only in this room, not there?
Cloud.
Cloud, okay. So cred and peer index also do similar things. They basically measure, there are different metrics of how effective you are on social media for different reasons. Cloud just measures how much content you're putting out there, which is well received. Peer index and cred, one of them determines how trustworthy your content is. And the other one determines how responsive you are and how other people are responsive to. So they're all metrics of how connected, and they're all valuing your content, which means they are validating your identity on Digitalia. Now, this is something that I've been listening to for the past 20 years. I don't know how many people can relate to this, but this is a cartoon saying some staff are saying that this new technology is killing conversation. You have parents, employers, friends, neighbors who say, yeah, all this connectivity and we are just getting disconnected. You give a person five different ways to connect and they're not having conversation. Okay, I can see some people in the back nodding. That whole Airtel ad, I can really relate to it even though I'm not 17 years old. The Airtel money ad, where the father is saying, pura din phone pe rehta hai. So this I've been hearing from a bunch of employers as well. This is something I think we cannot relate to. So we're standing in line waiting for half an hour for somebody to take our order, just listen to us as consumers. And we're saying, I don't want a ticket number, I just want a conversation, I want to talk to a human being. And what do they say? Madam, we will transfer you to another line. We will transfer you to the concern department. So I think it's not technology that's killing conversation, it's people who are killing conversation. And on Digitalia, conversation is everything. Conversation is transaction. So it can't be that technology is killing conversation, right? It's actually facilitating more conversation. This is a cartoon that appeared on Gaping Void. It says the main point of the internet is to remove barriers to socializing. Everything else is secondary. And that's another comic I picked up. I stole off Google Images, which says, why should people use comic chat? And there's a creature over there saying, because we cease to exist when the program is not running. I cease to exist as Ideasmith if I stop blogging, tweeting, Instagramming, and Facebooking. My readership and my interactions with the community completely vanish if I delete my WordPress blog. Another WordPress blog. Okay, nobody's listening. I should just stop mentioning WordPress. And finally, community is the asset that all of this goes to build. I don't think content is an asset. I hear a lot of people saying content is an asset. I think content is a means to the asset. Content is a means to draw conversations. Conversations build relationships. Relationships, when they're structured, build communities. This is just an example. I think I see a lot of people smiling, so I'm sure we've all enjoyed these guys. So I think all of us are part of this community. So I'm going to end this with this question. Who do you think constitutes the WordPress community?
People.
Yeah, I mean people. It's people who make any community. We've not yet started having communities of dogs and aliens, but what kind of people do you think make a WordPress community?
People who blog online.
People who blog online, okay. The developers don't have anything to say.
Yeah, it's because of the developers that people
blog. Absolutely. No, I agree. I'm not going to disagree with you. So, I've been part of a bunch of debates on techies versus users, techies versus content people. A lot of debates here. And you know what? I don't want to pick a side anymore. Not because I've been a technology person, but because I'm a creator. I create content, and you're a developer. You create tools that I'm able to use. So you are facilitating me, but you know what, I'm facilitating you as well. Because I blog on the tools that you use, a whole bunch of other people come and meet, so my needs define your existence. And your products define my existence. So I don't think one can exist without the other, and I think the WordPress community is really all of us. It's the users as well as the developers. So that's pretty much all I had. This is what an analog is of the digital space, and that's what a techno geek is doing on Digitalia. Questions? I was told I could ask questions. I could ask questions? No. Okay. I need to let you people ask questions. Questions? Okay, one quick plug. I'm Ideasmithy on Twitter and everywhere else, so you can shoot me any thoughts, questions, comments. Thank you. Thank you very much.